may I ask you to pray for the remainder of tonight? Because we're actually going to come to perhaps one of the most important points we can make in Bible study as we continue through this chapter. And I just pray that it can be communicated as God would want it to be communicated. Because we are coming to a climax here. Chapter 31 is the climax of Job. Not the book of Job, but of Job's speeches. In fact, at the end of it, it'll say the words of Job are finished. So, we come back to this. We've talked about this relationship. And this is the critical point, that Job is doing all these amazing things. Job is following, if we put it in Christian terms, the lead of the Holy Spirit. He's being transformed. Good things are happening. He's growing down that path of spiritual perfection. But there's still this dysfunction in his relationship with God. This, for I was in terror of calamity from God, and I could not have faced his majesty. But now the oath continues. Remember, this is the oath of innocence. So saying all these things, if I've done these things, let bad things happen to me. So he goes on to talk about greed and about idolatry. And we'll see something amazing about Job a little further down. So he says, if I have made gold my trust, or called fine gold my confidence, right? Greed. If I have rejoiced because my wealth was great, or because my hand had gotten much. If I have looked at the sun when it shone. This is not about enjoying nature. This is about idolatry, worshiping the sun, worshiping the moon. Okay. If I have looked at the sun when it shone, or the moon moving in splendor, and my heart has been secretly enticed, and my mouth has kissed my hand, which must have been some kind of idolatrous way of worshiping. This also would be an iniquity to be punished by the judges, for I should have been false to God above. And now this section is amazing. Look at the next two verses here in the context of the law. Remember, this is not the New Testament. This is not even Israel. Okay, we have the law that was again delivered to God to people who could only relate to God as humans. Right? They didn't have the Holy Spirit with them necessarily. Look at the level, the height of moral conduct that Job has here. If I have rejoiced at the ruin of him that hated me, or exulted when evil overtook him, I have not let my mouth sin by asking for his life with a curse. I mean, we don't see this until the New Testament. You know, bless those who curse you. Right? Love those who hate you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. Look at Job's words here. If I've rejoiced at the ruin of him that hated me, or exulted when evil overtook him, I have not let my mouth sin by asking for his life with a curse. The amazing, amazing spiritual maturity of Job. This is perhaps one of the greatest moral statements of the entire Old Testament. This could come right out of the mouth of Jesus, couldn't it? Another reason why I mentioned Job is perhaps the most New Testament book of the Old Testament. To see this level, this height of morality. So again, we come back to this idea that the Holy Spirit has done what the Holy Spirit will do. That it has transformed Job. And so Job is living in this amazing way towards his fellow human beings. He has let the life of the Spirit within him transform his relationship with his fellow human beings, but not his relationship with God. Okay? Again, important point. Job has let the Spirit shape his relationship with humans, but not with God. And so, lots of bold lines here. This is what I meant. That perhaps this is the single most important point of this entire Foundations of Bible Study series that we've been doing since May, for months and months and months. We've been laying the foundation, trying to understand this book, laying the context for this book. But it's not about knowledge. It's about this God who is love, who is our Father, who is our husband, who is our everything, who is our beloved. And so often we do the exact same thing. Right? Our Christianity grows and we're doing the right things, just like Job was doing the right things. We're letting the Holy Spirit work in us. We're letting grace be active. We're doing wonderful things, the things we're supposed to be doing. And we start to love our neighbor instead of hate them. We start to bless those who curse us, right? And pray for those who despitefully use us. And we let grace transform our relationship with others just like we're supposed to do. But when it comes to God, we hesitate. When it comes to God, we back off. And we let the life of the Holy Spirit, we let the life of grace reach out to those around us. But somehow we've been so misfed that we don't let it change our relationship with God. And I say sometimes, you know, great thanks to all of those who passed the faith along to us. Where would we be without their sacrifice? But sometimes those who have passed the faith along to us have also passed along some not so faithful things. And so we inherit these strange ideas about this distance, about this fear, that keeps us from going on to perfection. The most important point I can leave with you over this entire study is this. To let the Holy Spirit transform not just our relationship with others, but most importantly, to let the Holy Spirit transform our relationship with God. Just very simply, love Him. Right? This is what we were made for. This is what we were made to do. Not because God needed someone to love Him, not because He's anything less if we don't love Him, not because He didn't have enough love just within Himself. It's because He is love that He made us to love Him for our sake. So I encourage all of us to head home tonight to pray. Unfortunately, we don't have a place to pray here. I wish we did. But to think, have I fallen into this trap? Have I been like Job? Have I allowed God to transform and miraculously change my life into His love towards others, but I forgot about God Himself? Have I forgot about God Himself? And let's, with all our hearts, with all the grace that God has done to change what we are, turn back and love Him. Love Him. Leap into His lap. Rub your nose in His. Put your head on His shoulder. Fall to sleep in the arms of your beloved. Yes, we're living this life on earth, but let's live it in heaven at the same time. Let's love God. So the oath continues. If the men of my tent have not said, though there is not, who has not been filled with his meat? The sojourner has not lodged in the street. I've opened my doors to the wayfarer. Again, hospitality was so important in this culture. All right, so he's always opened his doors to the wayfarer. If I have concealed my transgressions from men by hiding my iniquity in my bosom, because I stood in great fear of the multitude and the contempt of families terrified me, if I'm a hypocrite, so that I kept silence and did not go out of doors, oh, that I had one to hear me. Again, you can just, this is real. This is not, you know, dry scripture. This is Job crying out in the middle of a thought. He just breaks his thought, right? If I've done all these things, oh, that I had one to hear me. Where are you, God? Here is my signature. Let the Almighty answer me. Oh, that I had the indictment written by my adversary. I don't even know what I've done wrong. I haven't been read my rights. I don't know what the charge is against me. Why am I being judged? Surely I'd carry it on my shoulder. I'd bind it on me as a crown. I'd give him an account of all my steps. I'd explain this to God. If only he'd listen. Like a prince, I'd approach him. And he comes back to the oath. If my land has cried out against me, and its furrows have wept together, if I have eaten its yield without payment, and caused the death of its owners, let thorns grow instead of wheat, and foul weeds instead of barley. I'm innocent. Here is my oath of innocence. Here's my public statement. In the absence of evidence, because God hasn't given any, here is my oath of innocence. And the words of Job are ended. So again, such deep pain. Pain that God was willing to not only inflict, but endure, because this is God seeing his child suffer. You know, and we know what that's like, right? Your child is sick and you just wish you'd give your right arm for them. You'd take the pain, wouldn't you? So God is suffering along with Job, and he's willing to do it. And let's see what happens next. Now we suddenly have a new character come on the scene, Elihu. Let's take a look at the beginning of chapter 32, where the words of Elihu begin. So these three men, the three friends, ceased to answer Job because he was righteous in his own eyes. All right, so there's no talking to Job, right? They haven't gotten through. Well, wait a second. Unless you read the Septuagint. Remember, we have these different versions of the Old Testament? Interestingly, the Septuagint says, so these men ceased to answer Job because he was righteous in their eyes. In other words, oh, yeah, Job is right. What's wrong with God? So it's an interesting point that we'll come to later, that sometimes we have to be careful about reading the Bible a little too closely. Remember, it communicates the Word of God. Let's take the big picture that God is communicating to us. But this gives us an idea of some of the difficulties of the text. So it could go either way. Did the three friends stop because there was no talking to Job? Or did the three friends stop because they agreed with him? And then this fellow Elihu speaks up. Elihu's name means he is God or he is my God. Often you see names with El in it, right? Elijah, Elisha, Ezekiel, all these names have El. El is the word for God. Okay, so we have Elihu, he is my God. Now, the words of Elihu are very likely a later addition to the book of Job. Still inspired, you know, it's still the word, communicates the word of God, it's still inspired, it doesn't change anything. It's not entirely concluded, but most biblical scholars will say this was probably added later. When we look at the words of Elihu, they're somewhat enigmatic. That Elihu comes across as kind of arrogant and pompous. But why? Is it because he is arrogant and pompous, or is he actually mocking the friends who have come across as so arrogant and pompous? And because he's taking both the friends and Job to task, he mocks the friends and their arrogance and their pompous to show them how stupid they sound. So interesting things with Elihu. What's also interesting is that Elihu is not criticized by God at the end. Remember at the beginning of the book we showed how God criticizes the friends? Actually takes them to cast. He says he's angry at them because they have not spoken right like his servant Job has. But he doesn't take Elihu to task. And again, we have to ask ourselves, is that because Elihu is right in what he's going to say? Or is it because Elihu is an addition, and so therefore whoever edited the text didn't add Elihu back into the end? Or is it both? Maybe he is right, and because he was right, they didn't have to add it in at the end? Well, we really don't know. But again, it highlights the danger of reading the text a little too closely. And we have to be careful about this. Kind of stepping away from the book of Job and back to concepts of Bible study. Remember that the Bible is a living word. It's a word through which God actively speaks on a daily basis, hopefully, to us. And so when it speaks to us, the way God is using it to communicate, it's not a textbook. It's a living book. And so we read it one day because God has something he wants to teach us. And something jumps out at us we didn't see before. And it is speaking to us where we are, here and now, for us. Now, 2 years later, we may read the same passage, and God has something else he wants us to learn. And something else jumps out, and we say, oh, I hadn't seen that before. Now, the danger we have is when we become so puffed up in our Bible study, and so puffed up because God is speaking to us, and that's a really neat thrill, that when God speaks to us here and today for us, that we now think that this is God's word for all people for all time. You know, and so we go out and found our own church based upon this particular little tiny doctrine that God has revealed to us and to only me. I'm important. You know, we have 40,000 or 40 million branches of Christianity all built around everybody being puffed up and thinking that what they saw in the scriptures now has to be applied to all people for all time. So just be careful about reading the text a little too closely. Now, God speaks to us through the Bible for today, for where we are, for us. It's a beautiful thing. Be careful about beating people over the head with God's message for us, because he might have a different message for them, right? We said, you know, Joe and John, you know, Joe, God says it's time to work on vanity, and Jim says it's time to work on lust. They both have a problem with both, you know, so the word is jumping out to Jim, and he's seeing all this lust, and so he looks at Joe, and he says, boy, is he lustful. and Joe over here, is God is speaking to him about vanity, and he says, boy, is Jim puffed up. As we judge each other, no, God is speaking to each of us, and we trust that God will bring his servants where they need to be. So, anyway, let's come back to the text. So we'll pick up in verse 2 where Elihu starts speaking. Then Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite, of the family of Ram, became angry. He was angry at Job because he justified himself rather than God. I keep saying, God, what's messed up here? What, you made a mistake. I haven't done anything. He was angry also at Job's three friends because they had found no answer, although they had declared Job to be in the wrong. And this is kind of interesting here. When the Jewish scholars compiled, I believe, Masoretic text, they made what were called the 18 emendations. I'm not sure. I really should brush up on this because I don't know if it was when the Masoretic text was made or whether this was an older tradition that made its way into both the Septuagint and the Masoretic text. I honestly don't recall. But we refer to the 18 emendations, where these scholars of the law literally changed what was in the Bible. Literally changed it because what it said just seemed to be so blasphemous, seemed to be so wrong that it couldn't be, and they changed it. And this is one of the places where they say they amended it because it actually says that they condemned God, not that they condemned Job. Which is kind of interesting because that supports the Septuagint reading before, doesn't it? That they stopped talking because Job was justified in their eyes. Right. Remember, we saw that up in verse 1. They ceased to answer Job because he was right in their eyes, said the Septuagint, which means they would have joined in this attributing this problem to God. So Elihu has a case to make against Job in verse 2 and against the friends. He was angry also at Job's three friends because they had found no answer, although they had condemned God, according to the emendation. Or they had condemned Job. Now, Elihu had waited to speak to Job because they, the friends, were older than he. And when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouth of these three friends, he became angry. So let's skip over the rest of 32. We'll go to chapter 33. And we'll change slides to continue on with the words of Elihu. So Elihu's speech is a little bit hard to follow. So I might actually do this a little backwards, tell you what he's saying, and then we'll actually read the text. So the first thing he says here in chapter 33 is that Job has nothing to fear from Elihu, as opposed to God. So remember, Job keeps saying about how he's terrified of God. And Elihu is saying, okay, well, I'm a fellow human like you. You don't need to fear me. Let's have a dialogue. Which is different than the friends who just condemn. All right? But now hear my speech, O Job, and listen to all my words. Behold, I open my mouth, the tongue of my mouth in my mouth speaks. My words declare the uprightness of my heart, and what my lips know they speak sincerely. The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty gives me life. Answer me if you can. Set your words in order before me, take your stand. So he's not condemning him. He's inviting him into dialogue. Now, there's not going to be a whole lot of dialogue, but at least he's not doing what the friends did. The friends were just wham, wham, you're wrong, Job, you're wrong, Job. Repent, Job, change, Job, you must have done evil. And Elihu isn't. Elihu is taking a different approach. Okay, answer me if you can. Set your words in order before me. Take your stand. Behold, I am towards God as you are. I too was formed from a piece of clay. Behold, no fear of me need terrify you. My pressure will not be heavy upon you. Okay, surely you have spoken in my hearing, and I've heard the sound of your words. Okay, some acknowledgement, finally. Now he comes back and paraphrases what Job has said. You say, I'm clean, without transgression. I'm pure, and there is no iniquity in me. All right, that's what Job has been saying. Behold, he finds occasions against me. He counts me as his enemy. Right, this adversarial relationship that Job was complaining about. He puts my feet in the stocks and watches all my paths. And instead now, Elihu is going to disagree. He's going to say, no, he's not punishing you, which is different from the friends. The friends have been insistent that Job is being punished by God because, and therefore, Job must have sinned. And it just goes around in circles and it gets really, really ugly. Elihu is not saying that. He's now going to say, no, God is not punishing you. Now we continue on. Behold, in this you are not right. I will answer you. God is greater than man. Why do you contend against him, saying, he will answer none of my words? For God speaks in one way and in two, though man does not perceive it. So remember, Job has been complaining that God isn't listening. Where is God? He's not there. And Elihu is saying, yes, he is. Yes, he is. You're just not hearing it. And then he goes on to elaborate how. Here's the first way that God speaks. Okay, he said one way, two ways. In a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falls upon men while they slumber on their beds, then he opens the ears of men and terrifies them with warnings. Now notice this subtlety of the next two verses. And this is the big difference. So he terrifies them on their beds with warnings that he may turn man aside from his deed and cut off pride from man. He keeps back his soul from the pit, his life from perishing by the sword. I wonder if you picked up the difference. The friends were saying God does this to punish you. Elihu is saying no. God is doing this to save you. God is doing this to spare you. So he terrifies these people. He sends these dreams. He sends these warnings that they can turn aside from their deed, cut off pride, that he keeps back his soul from the pit, his life from perishing by the sword. So the point is that God is out to help men, to help people, to help us, not to punish us. He's not the God we do good things for to keep him off our back, because if we get him upset, he's going to zot us. He's actually on our side. Everything he's doing is for us, not looking for an opportunity to punish us. Again, something we see so much in the New Testament. Let's digress into a few scriptures. Let's go over to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 24 to 26. Okay, this is such a radically different perspective from the friends. The friends are stuck in law, sin, punishment. Rules, obedience, blessing. It's mechanical. It's accounting. It's not relational. It's not love. Elihu is saying, yeah, these things happen, but not for punishment, for love. Just like we read here. I believe this is speaking of a bishop. I don't think it's a deacon, not sure. But it says, the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kindly to everyone, an apt teacher, forbearing, you know, putting up with stuff, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant that they will repent and come to know the truth, that they may escape from the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will. Okay, so this is all about helping, turning people around, bringing them to good. Remember, we were in Ezekiel 18? Remember that very last verse of Ezekiel 18, Ezekiel 18:32? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord. So turn and live. It's not about I want to zot you. It's not about I want to keep a record. It's not I want to keep an accounting of your good and your bad, and if you fall below the line, you're gone. It's I don't want to punish you. I don't want you to die. Please turn and live. And again, we see so clearly, once again, we'll go back to Timothy, but this time 1 Timothy, also chapter 2 and verse 4. Speaking of God, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. It's not about who can I get out of the game, who can I find fault with to knock out of the game, but rather to bring all people if they're willing to listen. So he's willing to terrify them with dreams. He's willing to hit them with the visions. He's willing to throw them in turmoil to try to bring them to change, not for punishment, but for love, for care, for concern, for their sake. These are the points that Elihu is starting to make. And now it gets even more interesting. So now he comes to the second way. In fact, new slide. He comes to the second way that God speaks. And interestingly, the second way God speaks is through suffering itself. What Job, the exact thing that Job is experiencing. Man is also chastened with pain upon his bed and with continual strife in his bones, so that his life loathes bread and his appetite dainty food. His flesh is so wasted away that it cannot be seen, just like Job was describing, right? That it cannot be seen, and his bones, which were not seen, stick out. His soul draws near the pit, and his life to those who bring death. So God is speaking to us the second way, exactly through suffering, not as punishment, but as communication. Let's continue on. You know, if there be for him an angel, a mediator, one of the thousands to declare to a man what is right for him, what's good for him, and he is gracious to him and says, deliver him from going down to the pit, I have found a ransom. Interesting. Hard to say, but is this a reference to Christ's ransoming us? Christ delivering us? It's not about trying to zot him. It's about willing to even pay the price for him, to ransom him. Let his flesh become fresh with youth. Let him return to the days of his youthful vigor. Then man prays to God and he accepts him. He comes into his presence with joy. He recounts to men his salvation. Now, this is this restoration, but it's not a reinforcement mechanism. It's not rewards and punishment. It is rewards and punishment, but not as an end, as a means. Not punishment for breaking the law, not rewards for doing good things, but it's the suffering and this relief from suffering that's to bring us to grow, to change, to being closer to God, and then to bring us to recounting our salvation. And he sings before men and says, corrupted text here, it's corrupted text on my electronic copy, not in Job. He recounts to men his salvation, and he sings before men and says, I have sinned and perverted what is right, and it was not requited to me. I have sinned and perverted what was right, and it was not requited to me. Now, interesting. This just answers a whole lot of issues. This is like Jonah, right? Jonah, the Ninevites sin. Jonah goes to them, and they repent, and they're not requited for what they had done. They find forgiveness. And so here, remember what the friends are saying. You know, your sin, you're going to be punished. But he's saying, no, they're not requited according to their works, which is what Job has been saying. But Job has been saying the other. He's saying, but wait a second, you have all these wicked, and they're doing wicked things, and God isn't punishing them. What's wrong? They're not being requited for what they have done, because it's not accounting. It's not rules, sin, punishment. It's, what can I do, God speaking, to bring them to me? Through blessings, through afflictions. What can I do to draw them to me? Okay. So this man who has suffered and been restored sings before men and says, I'd sinned and perverted what was right, and it was not requited to me. He has redeemed my soul from going down into the pit, and my life shall see light. Behold, God does all these things twice, three times with a man, to bring back his soul from the pit that he may see the light of life. It's not about punishment and about reward. It's about, what do I do to bring them to life? What do I do to bring them to salvation? See how different Elihu's approach is? Perhaps why God does not condemn Elihu at the end of this? Interestingly, the rest of this chapter is probably actually the beginning of chapter 35. Again, showing how difficult this text is, how it is a little mangled. Okay, but in any event, let's continue on. So we'll go on to chapter 34. Chapter 34, the argument gets even a little more difficult to follow. So, in chapter 34, well, let's start and see where he comes out. So Elihu says, hear my words, you wise men, and give ear to me, you who know, for the ear tests words as the palate tastes food. Let us choose what is right. Let us determine among ourselves what is good. Okay, so he's proposing a different approach. He's proposing rather than condemning. The friends were always condemning. And now, what he's going to say in the next several verses is that he's not disagreeing with Job that there appears to be a lack of justice. He'll grant Job that. But what he takes issue with is Job attributing this as a defect of God. So that's what's going on here from verses 5 to 11. For Job has said, I'm innocent, and God has taken away my right. In spite of my right, I am counted a liar. My wound is incurable, though I am without transgression. Right? That's Job's argument. That's what Job has been saying. What man is like Job, who drinks up scoffing like water, who goes in company with evildoers and walks with wicked men? For he has said, it profits a man nothing that he should take delight in God. Therefore, hear me, you men of understanding. Far be it from God that he should do wickedness, and from the Almighty that he should do wrong. For according to the work of a man, he will requite him, and according to his ways, he will make it befall him. But not in the way the friends or Job say. So now that the gist of the next few verses, 12 through 15, are that it's not up to us to define justice. God defines justice. If we define justice and then wonder why God doesn't match our picture of justice, this is a problem. This is what Elihu is going to tell us now. So in verse 12, of a truth, God will not do wickedly, and the Almighty will not pervert justice. Who gave him charge over the earth, or who laid him on the whole world? In other words, God isn't subordinate. God's at the top of the pile. God defines reality. He defines justice. If he should take back his spirit to himself and gather to himself his breath, all flesh would perish together, and man would return to the dust. Okay, so this is his argument, that we're in trouble because we got things backwards. We're saying, I've got this picture of justice and God doesn't match it. And Elihu was saying, no. God is the one who has made everything. He stops, he says, it's over and it's over. God is the one who defines justice. And sometimes we do get this wrong. Right? We sometimes tend to think in human terms and want God to conform to them. Right? So we have a human version of what good is, and we say God is good. Well, no. God is God, and that defines what good is. Okay, it's not we have this definition and then we say, oh, God happens to match this definition, so therefore God must be good.
No.
God is the definition of good. God is the definition of wise. God is the definition of love. And so, if what God does doesn't match our definition of love, it doesn't mean that God doesn't love. It means that our definition of love is wrong. If God doesn't match our definition of good, it doesn't mean that God isn't good. It means that our definition of good is wrong and needs to be conformed to God. God defines reality. God defines good. God defines love. God defines perfection. God defines justice. And if we're out of sync with it, the problem is not with God. The problem is with us. Okay, and this is what Elihu is trying to get across to Job. Let's skip down a little bit. We have time. Actually, we don't. This is a good time to break because we do have a lot of very important stuff to cover that will fill next week. So hopefully it's whetting your appetite for what's to come. We've already hit one of the climaxes, the end of the words of Job. And again, I can't emphasize that enough. Let me go back to that slide just because it is so important. That remember we said that Job had allowed the Holy Spirit to transform his relationship with his fellow human beings, but hadn't let it transform his relationship with God. That's the biggest takeaway from the last 9 months or however long we've been doing this. So take that home with you. So that's the first climax. And now the words of Elihu are going to bring us through to the second climax where God himself addresses Job. And we see Job come to an incredibly deep self-knowledge. And once he comes to self-knowledge, he's able to come to perfection of being molded into the image of God, to love as God loves, and to banish his fear. So that will pick up next week. All right, so with that, let's pray and head on our way. Truly, our love, you who are indeed all things, you define reality and yet we crawl up into your lap. How amazing is that? You stretch out the heavens and yet we fall asleep in your arms. Who can possibly imagine or be worthy of such love? Please, Lord, we pray, in love for you, the love you've given to us, please help us to see where we're still holding back. Help us to see where we're, I don't know, still only on the second date. We're not married yet. You know, help us to see where we're still feeling you out. And please help us cast aside all restraint and just leap into your arms in full trust and in full love, despite our imperfections, knowing that you love us. Change us, Lord. For when we fall in love with you, we will truly love everyone else and make this world beautiful beyond comprehension. That around us shines your light because we are in love with you. Bless us, Lord, that we may bless others. And thank you so much through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. All right, till next week.